Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. As you can see today, I have a guest. Steve Donahue is joining me today for another episode of our new series, the Micah Dialogues, which we've done a couple episodes on. It's been really fun, and today we're hosting it on my channel instead of Steve's, which I'm very excited about. And we have a very interesting topic for today as well, and that is BookTube life balance, sort of. Doing BookTube and all of the commitments that come along with that, along with, in my case, having a job and a couple other sort of elements thrown into the mix there, which
Yeah,
is
it's a very
quite a lot to
Micah-centric,
cover.
very Micah-centric topic. It's perfectly okay that it's on your channel. Although,
Absolutely.
I guess our contention is that it's not just you, right?
No,
That
absolutely not. It's many, many
it's a
others.
fascinating subject just in general.
It is. And it's something that even crosses over into your life, even though
At the
you are
moment,
very much
yes.
reader focused, you have a lot of other things going on as well.
Sometimes I do.
Sometimes.
It's this particular week, I do. This particular week, the subject is on my mind because it now is one of the only times where I can actually really identify with everybody else. But this is not how you started BookTube.
No.
When you
Yes.
started BookTube, you had wide open spaces in your schedule.
Right. I started it sort of in between having being done with a part-time job, being done with part-time school, going into just having open days completely devoted to reading and making videos, and then going right into a full-time job. Basically all of that free time being removed just to weekends, and then throwing on top of that, other responsibilities and things that needed to be done. So it definitely shifted completely from when I first started.
Do you think that there are a lot of people who found BookTube and thought, I can do that, I can try it during COVID, who are now having the same
Absolutely.
thing?
Absolutely. That was me too. It
That was you too. Oh my God.
was me too
Okay,
of
that is the
discovering
timing,
it,
right?
discovered it during COVID, and I know of at least three or four other channels that were that same story of started during COVID. And then things have gone a little bit more back to normal in the workplace. People are back working more than they were during COVID. And then it's sort of everything hits of, oh, this was a lot easier when there was nothing else going on. And then throwing that on top of other responsibilities, it can become quite daunting.
So you have a full-time job out in the real world,
I do.
job with a pants requirement and everything.
Pants requirement every day,
So,
regardless of how I feel.
not even Fridays?
Not even Fridays.
Oh God,
Not even
that's
Fridays.
just brutal. We might as well be back in the Soviet Union. But I remember, despite what BookTube thinks, I did that myself for a quarter
Yes.
of a century. I remember what it was like, and we're not talking about an 8-hour workday. Right? You get up, you want to walk around a little, have a breakfast,
Yep.
maybe get in a workout before you go to work. Then you get to work. Then you're at work for that whole time. Then you come back, and nobody comes back from an 8 or a 9 hour work shift and is ready to just go bang right into whatever else they want to do. They're a little bit fried.
Yep. Then
Perfectly
there are the
natural.
things you need to do.
And there are also things you need to do.
Muscle up some food.
A little bit disturbs me that people get frazzled and fried at the end of a 9-hour workday, and then they get on the road in a 2,000-pound piece of metal. But
Yes.
even if you manage to put off the decompression until you get home to the couch, the decompression is still real,
Absolutely.
right? And you've got to make supper,
Yep.
and you have friends and family, don't you?
I do.
So yet more weights around your ankles.
Yes, indeed.
They require petting and cooing every once in a while, though they get fractious and start soiling the carpet.
Exactly. We need a little bit of attention from me.
And in addition to all of that, there's another element stalking the conversation that I don't know about, which is that for 9 hours also you have to be a shapeless blob drooling on your pillow.
It's very true.
And
Very
I'm
true.
willing to bet even at your young age, there are days when it's 6 in the afternoon, and you find yourself looking forward to
Absolutely.
that.
Absolutely. I admit it. I admit it.
That's called being tired, if I remember
Yes.
correctly.
Yes. A strange sensation for you, I'm sure.
So, And when I was just about to apologize for doing all the talking, but I don't think anyone would believe that.
No, don't apologize if you don't mean it. Baseless apologies.
I ought to try that sometime. You were on your channel.
I'm so sorry for talking.
I'm so sorry for dominating.
I'm so sorry.
I wonder what comments I'd get. But I do have questions. Because yes. Surely that pattern, day after day after day, get up, get in some exercise,
yeah,
have a good breakfast, go to work, get your work done, the thinking about the work before you even get there, the getting to work, the right. work, the getting back home, the reconnecting with your non-work life, your non-work people, a meal. Surely doing all of that means that in your mind, the whole time, you are mentally storing up the things you want to do on the weekend.
Right.
Right. That's the whole mythology about the weekend. Thank God right. it's the weekend. I'm right. going to get everything done on the weekend.
Yes.
There's a weight to that, right? I mean, there's almost we could call it a weight to that.
When, absolutely.
So many people get insensate drunk on Friday night because they've got all this pent up tension.
Yeah.
That's got to crowd out BookTube as well. Right?
It does. I think it has to.
A lot of those things that you're slowly, you know, putting in a bank in the back of your mind on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday are not, ooh, making videos. There are all sorts of other things.
Right, right. For me, it's probably BookTube heavy. It's slanted towards BookTube because I don't have a whole lot of other things going on. But yes, it's sort of the accumulation throughout the week of sort of stockpiling all of the hopes and aspirations for the weekend. And then you get to the weekend and you're just really tired from the week previous. So then you spend most of your weekend trying to build the mental power to do the things you want to do. And before you know it, it's Sunday evening and you've done one of the things you wanted to do and the whole clock resets and it's time to start banking towards the next weekend.
And we should stress here just a quick parenthetical that BookTube is fun.
Absolutely.
It is something you could legitimately look forward to doing.
And
there are lots of other things too.
Right. It's a good looking forward to. I should have clarified that.
But okay, so one consideration that I have given that pattern that we're pretty much agreeing that that is kind of the pattern that you fall into when you're working 40 hours a week. Does it ever occur to you? I mean, or how strongly does it occur to you maybe in the morning or during a work day that you're going to make time to make a video at night after a work?
I think it occurs to me often throughout the week and I attempt to. And typically what happens is I end up sort of saying, okay, this night I'm going to make a video. And then I get home and the real thing I want to do is I want to read. I want to sit down and I want to use whatever time I have to read and say, okay, I'll push the video off to the next night. You know, I just want to read tonight. I don't want to have to do anything beyond just me and a book.
This is
I think that's similar for a lot of people.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. I would hope so.
It's the incredible irony of the BookTube community is that almost right. always the choice you're faced with is, do I make BookTube videos or do I read?
Right.
There's an incredible irony there.
Or do I watch BookTube videos or make them or watch even. Or read? That's something I've found out too, is that there is another element. It's not just read and film. It's read, film, and watch. And read, film, watch, and comment and engage.
Right.
Across a wide spectrum of channels.
Right. Right. Well, watching a wide spectrum of channels was probably your first mistake.
Right. I should just be watching yours.
I was going to make a sarcastic comment about how some BookTubers don't make that dilemma any easier because they make multiple videos a week.
Yes.
But actually,
everyone should just watch your channel. You give enough videos. Some BookTubers
make multiple videos a day. So that doesn't help things at all.
Your channel produces the same amount of content that other channels do in a month or in 2 months. It's impressive.
So what goes on in your mind when you come up against that dilemma? Plenty of other booktubers have come up against that dilemma. We've seen it, right? Michael K. Vaughn just announced the other day that he was going to limit the number of videos that he makes because it was actually cutting into reading time in a very busy life.
Right.
And we've seen him and many other booktubers who make it clear in the video that you're watching that they've only got 15 minutes.
Yeah.
They've got to get out the door or something like that. Where the real world is not only curtailing their time, but governing it.
Right.
So and what does
see many feel? Leave as well from just deciding that they can't even do the smallest bit. They just need to completely remove themselves and we lose them entirely.
Right. Right. That's true. That I think is that I just don't have time for this anymore. It's a big reason why we lose people. I think another reason why we lose people is maybe connected, which is that they start to think, well, this is, I went into this in order to make my reading life a little less solitary, but this is
right.
This is too crowded.
Right.
I don't want this to be public.
Sort of you hit the other end of that, of you want it to be less solitary, and then suddenly you're like, it's too public. That's not me. Yeah. But more saying that might be the feeling that some of the people have when they just decide to pull the plug entirely, of saying, yeah, I wanted it to be social, but this is too social. I don't have any time just to have it be me in a book.
I get the impression that a lot of those people stop watching too, because you're right. It is three things: it's reading, it's making videos, and it's watching videos.
Right. Sort of that combination of those three elements. You don't have to be a viewer. I know plenty of channels that they're just content creators and they don't engage on other people's videos. They may not even watch other people's videos. But I think it's nice to engage with other channels.
Yeah.
To watch other content and not just be producing but not engaging.
I guess I know some of those channels myself. We don't have to name any names, but when watching their videos, do you ever wonder why they do it?
Can you imagine
making videos if there was no community aspect of it?
When they never reference other channels, or they're not talking about other projects or mentioning other creators.
Yeah.
It's very limited.
I mean, if you're watching, it must cross your mind to ask, why would this person do this? Do you have any explanations? Honing their audio visual skills?
For some of those channels, they do have larger audiences. I'm not going to name any, but there are a couple that I've seen that have huge followings. And so at that point,
it could just be a job.
For smaller channels that do that, I have to think it's just sort of they have decided that it's that all they can do is film their own videos, but they can't do the watching. They can't do the engagement with the community. And so they've just made that decision. But to me, it feels that removes one of the best elements of the community, which is the community itself.
So would you say, I mean, there are going to be new booktubers watching this. They don't watch my channel. They're terrified they might end up like me, but they watch your channel. would you say to a prospective new booktuber that a serious thing you have to think about is to ask yourself whether or not you have the time to do this?
I do. I do think so. Just if you want to do it where you're very engaged, I think you can get by on a smaller time scale if you don't do the same level of engagement. If you just put out one video a week or one video every 2 weeks and you're not watching other channels, you're not participating in buddy reads or read-alongs or reading events, all you do is you just film a video about whatever book you're reading and that's it. But if you want to be engaged, I definitely think that it takes some consideration because it's quite a big commitment, quite a big time commitment, especially if you are trying to sort of weave that into an already fairly structured life that's really sort of structured out of your control. If you have in a job, or if you're a student where you have sort of, you know, large takes on your time already, I would definitely say you would have to consider that.
Or if you've got a crowd of unruly imaginary booktube friends constantly making demands on you.
Yes.
I don't know if that's in my control or not. Sometimes it feels like it's not. When one after another of them pipes up on Voxer or an email and says, you owe us five videos a day.
Yes. Well, you've created a monster, essentially.
Where I want to, I have said many times, there's no other channel that does that. How on earth can you think you should expect that?
And you have no one to blame but yourself for this behavior.
It's true. It's true.
It's been
your comments,
5 years.
That comment about something to a prospective new BookTuber raises a fascinating question. Of course, all my questions are fascinating. It's a burden that I bear. I can't help it. But if you discovered BookTube last week, would you have made a channel? Or would you have sat back against the backdrop of your custom-made bookshelf and say, I don't have the time to do this. I'm perfectly happy to comment on channels, but I don't have the time to make one of my own.
I'm not sure if I wouldn't do it, but I think that it would be a much longer consideration process than when I originally started my channel. I would definitely have to think about it a lot more, and I probably would do it in a different way than I'm doing now. Probably a little bit more of that disconnected route. It probably would be me filming videos and posting them, but not really engaging with other channels, not doing reading events or read-alongs, and that much more sort of dissociated type of channel pulled away from the community, just because of the time. That's a very interesting question. I haven't thought of that before.
Do you feel a growing burnout? Are you vulnerable?
I don't feel a burnout.
BookTube burnout?
I don't feel a burnout, but I definitely feel sort of a feeling of wanting to make sure that I'm not losing quality or losing how I want my channel to be by taking on too much. Because BookTube is full of such fantastic reading events and opportunities and creators to do collaborations with, that it's very easy, at least for me, to just take on too much because I want to experience it all. I want to read all the books. I want to be a part of all the events. I want to be in all the groups. And you sort of realize it's very easy to get into all of those. You're one Voxer message away, you're one email away from being involved in a group reading something. And it's very hard then to fulfill that obligation when you suddenly find yourself in six reading events for a month and you're trying to read all of these books and make all these videos. But it's not a bad thing. And so there's no burnout, but there's definitely a feeling of making sure that I put on my own personal brake pads and don't get myself in a situation where I have to start flaking out on people or backing out of things.
No, I was going to point that out, that yes, that it's very your one Voxer message away. It's very easy to do that. But on the other hand, this is a remarkable assortment of people that you would never meet in your normal life. These are the bookish friends that book people always want.
Absolutely.
That is absolutely real. That's not just...
And that you'll never meet, or I shouldn't say you would never meet, but you would most likely not meet if you weren't a part of this community.
Right. And those group events enhance your appreciation of the book you're dealing with, whatever book it is.
Absolutely. That has been the most surprising discovery for me with my own channel, of the fact that I'm doing group readings now, group reading events or readathons or buddy reads or whatever you want to label them as. That was something that I didn't know it existed before BookTube, but also I never imagined sort of the benefits that would hold. And so that's why I really feel that if you want to do a BookTube channel, if you want to be a part of the community, you have to go all the way if you want to get the full benefit of the community. That if you create videos but you're not participating in events, I feel like you are sort of shortchanging yourself in a way. But then obviously that does add on to the time commitment as well.
That element of it surprised me too. I not just being involved in a group read of something or a theme thing like, you know, a June on the Range or something, but right. Just watching someone or a group of people go through a book, even if I'm not involved in their read along, because they think I'm Satan incarnate. And for some people, the fact that they think I'm Satan incarnate is a deal breaker. Other people know perfectly well that I'm Satan incarnate. They're still willing
to go along with it.
Right. It's not a deal breaker for them. They're okay with it. It reminded me of teaching.
Interesting.
When you're teaching, there is no doubt that you know the material better than your students. And the pitfall that so many teachers fall into is thinking that knowledge is the only way to improve your understanding or appreciation of a book. When it's not, it's only one way.
Interesting.
It is entirely possible for me to watch a group of people doing a very enthusiastic read-along of a book that critically I know I'm not going to change my mind on. I know that it's bad, in other words. And yet, I'm enraptured the whole time. Enthusiasm means so much. Also, meticulous attention to detail, but especially enthusiasm. Right. I loved this, and here's why. There's no way to discount that. And yet, so many teachers do. There is no way to discount that statement. I love this, and here's why. And if I'm watching a BookTube event when people are going through some book, or one person is going through some book, sometimes it'll take them a month. Chapter by chapter, section by section, I couldn't be more enthusiastic in watching.
Yes.
I did not see that coming. For some reason, I didn't think that would happen.
Right.
Sorry, I'm very distracted.
You're fine. I think...
There's a patch of green grass within sight of the window, and sitting upright in the middle of the patch of green grass is a rabbit. And the rabbit has been sitting bolt upright, not eating, not chewing on anything, not moving, and staring directly at me the whole time. I don't know what is going on here.
It's just trying to watch your channel too.
It's like a, I don't know, a fourth of a mile away.
Just enamored.
It can't possibly see me. It's staring directly.
There must be something right in the middle of that visual sight. It's looking at something.
I guess. It senses, you know, its own Satan incarnate. It senses tried her hands at a rabbit.
Yes.
She tried her hands at most other things, but not at a rabbit. Never come close enough.
I wonder if she can tell it's there. She seems to be pretty calm.
We went down the front steps the other night. It's very much rabbit season. They're all over the place. I don't know if that's true where you are. They're all over the place now. They must the young one must be must have just reached maturity, but they're absolutely everywhere. I forget, what is a young rabbit called? No, it's not a yearling.
What is it?
There's a word, and I forget what it is.
I know.
Outside, and we just rounded the corner on the front steps, and on the sidewalk, right next to the hedges, was this tiny little hamster-sized baby rabbit.
Oh, cute!
And Frida looked at it and said, even before her hunting instincts could trigger, she said, "You've got to be kidding me." And the thing disappeared. She hesitated for just a second because she couldn't believe anything could be so dumb.
Yes. She thought she was going to get lucky.
But to get back to the subject.
Yes.
So what are the strategies that you have adopted? Is this mostly been piecemeal? The piecemeal strategy is I will simply film on the weekends and I really won't think about it during the week.
That has been a strategy of mine of late, of sort of, all right, during the week, sort of, it's a stockpiling of ideas. That's when I'm doing the bulk of my reading, instead of on the weekends, but on the weeknights and in the mornings. And then on the weekends, okay, now it's time to film. I have my week's worth of reading and thoughts on it. I know what I want to film, and then, okay, this weekend, we'll put together a couple of videos. Okay. And then during the week, it's more sort of getting through the material, but then will allow me. So getting through the material for the group reads or for Classics and Company, which I'm doing right now. And then on the weekends, all right, now we'll talk about it in my weekend reading update or in a Beowulf video that we're, you know, for April with our four different translations. So that has been my main strategy as
of late. Does that strategy increase your enthusiasm for making videos? Does that increase?
It does because it sort of I think by sort of stretching it out a little bit, the time between filming and giving myself more time to get material, to get to get through a little bit more material during the week, then I'm, first of all, more enthusiastic about filming because it gives me a little bit of time to wait and build up anticipation for it. But then also I feel much more locked into what I want to talk about. And it's not so much of a scattered feeling. Whereas when I was trying to film videos sort of throughout the week, but wasn't getting enough of the time dedicated that I needed to the actual reading, I felt that I was able to get a video out, but I felt very shallow in what I was saying. I didn't feel like I was delivering the information that I wanted to. Whereas now sort of giving myself more time between filming, doing a little bit less output, but more quality for that output, then I feel better about the quality of what I'm delivering.
I employ something of the same strategy. I will sometimes build my own enthusiasm by waiting as much as a minute between videos. it really does add an edge to things there.
You wait 1 minute before just clicking on.
Well, now I'm all built up. I don't want to get burnt out or anything. But does the same thing apply to you in terms of watching BookTube? Do you find that watching BookTube tends to wait for the weekends?
It's almost flipped for me. I actually watch very little BookTube during the weekends. And most of that happens during the weekdays. Mornings before work is typically one of my bigger viewing times. And I think what comes from that is sort of the strange feeling that comes from when you know you're leaving the house and you're going off to work. There's that weird period of time, and I've heard you talk about this on your videos before. There's a weird period of time where you don't really want to read because you know you have 10 minutes or 15 minutes till you're about to be leaving. So it's not enough time to get lost in a book, or you don't want to get lost in it and then have to pull yourself out and go to your job for the day, and then you're sort of distracted and in this weird mind frame because you've been pulled out of your book. So I tend to use that time for BookTube watching, watch a video or two before work. And then the sort of the same thing for, on a lunch break or coming home or after you come home from work, sort of that strange period while there are still other things going on, the day hasn't completely calmed down yet. And so those periods of time, you can sort of read in them, but I tend to insert my viewing time into those periods just because I feel that's a better use for me instead of sort of a distracted reading, do be able to just use that time to catch up on the channels that I follow.
Yeah, in my retail days, I used that period. I believe that period where you have to sort of defrazzle yourself. I think that's true even if you love your job.
Absolutely. Yeah, I love my job. I enjoy my time there. I don't dread going to work. I enjoy being there, but there's still that period of sort of letting your brain sort of switch back to, okay, I'm home now.
Yeah.
And then let the gears, do their thing, and then you're back into home mode. Because even when you love what you do, you still have two versions of yourself. There's the version of you at work, and there's the version of you at home. And so you have to sort of let yourself decompress and shift.
Are we talking about pants again? Did we go back to talking about pants?
You have to put your pants on and leave the house. Pants version and unpantsed version.
That didn't used to be true in my immediate neighborhood, but there was some sort of petition that went around, and now it is. Now it is true. I don't understand how these things happen.
now you two are forced to wear pants.
But I used to make sure during my retail days, tried to make sure that I was not using a dog walk for that decompression time.
Interesting.
That dog walk belongs to the dog. And that decompression time is you hashing out arguments or frustrations from work, getting rid of all sorts of junk.
Right.
That's it's not fair, I don't think, to walk dogs under circumstances like that. So I tried not to do it. But what do you foresee then? The pattern that you're describing now, where you do, you fill in the interstitial moments of the week with watching BookTube, but you don't tend to make videos until the weekend.
Right.
And that's not only because you want to preserve reading time, but also because you want to avoid burnout. Does this pattern strike you as workable?
I think so. I think even it will morph as I have more time sort of balancing working full time and having a BookTube channel. My channel is only a year old and I've only been working a full time job for 6 months or 5 months. So not a lot of time for either of those two things. Very short period of time, you know, when considering the full length of how long I'll be able to maintain both of these. And so I do see an increase in the future of being able to balance doing more videos, watching more videos, reading more, sort of just as phases of life shift and new things are added and old things are dropped off. But I think for now, sort of I found the best way to maintain avoiding burnout and keeping myself present in the community and at an enjoyable level where I don't feel that I'm missing out, but I also don't feel like I'm sort of overcommitting myself or stretching myself to the breaking point either.
And it's got to be possible, right? There are BookTubers who've been doing this for years.
Absolutely.
With a full-time job and with full-time and also kids.
Both MJ and Ollie work full-time and they put out a video every day. And they're doing reading events and Ollie reads 5,000 books a week and they keep it up. So it's certainly very possible. And there are many others, I'm sure. I'm blanking on names.
So there's hope, in
yes.
other words.
Yes,
a comment that you could extend to prospective new BookTubers.
Absolutely. There's
looking at your channel and thinking, I might want to try this.
Right. I think the most important thing to remember is that you have to BookTube the way that works for you. Everybody is, even people with similar schedules, everyone is unique. Everyone handles stress differently or they handle schedules differently. They handle that detox period differently. I know of some people who don't need that. And I know some people who need even more than I do. So I know people who can just, you know, flip the switch from work mode to home mode and go, go, go all the time. I know other people who need an hour or 2 hours or an entire evening of nothing going on to decompress. And so I think my biggest piece of advice would have to be figure out what works best for you. And you can't really model too much off of other people until you are sure of what works best for you. And then you can take advice from other people. But I would say don't try to mimic someone else's schedule of posting. And that's something I used to try to do. I used to try to say, okay, this channel posts videos on these days and they're this long. So I'm going to try to do that too. But that seems to be the right way to do it. And I think that's just a good way to lead yourself to being very frustrated with yourself of when you're saying, well, why can't I keep up with this person's schedule? We work the same amount of hours
right.
every day.
Right.
We both have families or we both have this or that or the other thing. And it's just any form of comparison can only do you harm in the end when it's with other people. And that would be my biggest piece of advice.
That's what the tech dudes say. The mantra they love to repeat over and over again is comparison is the thief of joy. I think because they got it from Warren Buffett or Ryan
yes.
Hawk or something.
Right. Right.
I always say, whenever one of them says that about a new iPad or whatever, I always say out loud to the screen, your channel is literally about comparison.
You know, it's titled comparing this to that.
You don't get to recite that mantra. You go with some other mantra. Go back to saying that you're a conglomeration of the five people you spend the most time with. Do that instead. Well, this is good news in a way.
It is.
That you might stick around.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I think it's actually, I guess I have another piece of advice actually here for the very end here, which would be that you have to also allow yourself to have a bit of a change, have a bit of a growth period where you can't just become locked into one schedule. You have to let yourself sort of have a flow and have flexibility. And if you go from 1 month of being able to do a bunch of videos and the next month you feel that you're not able to keep up with that, change your schedule a little bit instead of just feeling like, oh, I can't do BookTube because I can't put out 12 videos a week. Or, you know, and don't let it discourage you, but treat it as an opportunity for growth and for changing. Because
there are BookTubers,
life's all about changing. If you're not changing.
Not everybody has to make a video a day.
Right. Or even a video a week. If people really like, you will find an audience that likes your videos and they will like them no matter the frequency. And even there is something to be said for the sparsity. of your audience looking forward to something too. So
really? Is that so?
Not for your channel. They need the 5 videos a day. But for other people, I know of channels that I know that they post more sparsely. So I look forward to when I see one of their videos come out. And those are the videos that I'm more likely to watch right away when I see it. Because, I've been waiting 2 weeks for
legitimately video. Said that nobody looks forward to my videos. They just sort of happen. My videos are sort of like shingles. Just sort of happen.
5 more videos from Steve. There's my evening.
The good news is that in looking at the work, reading, BookTube balance, you think that you might be able to manage a channel with a job.
I do.
But the bad news is that means we might all be stuck with Aaron Facer. That's a bitter pill to swallow. I was kind of hoping this whole discussion was leading up to us assuming that he would be gone.
I think he has the skills to handle it.
Yes.
We're going to have both of us for a very long time.
You have to play it by ear for your own life, the circumstances of your own life.
Exactly.
But it making just a peremptory decision, this thing has to go, no matter how much I'm enjoying it. Too many books have already made that decision.
Right. I think it's a very rash decision. And it's quite a drastic decision as well.
Well, look at how much you get from
BookTube. I'm pulling out from everything.
Look at how much you get out of it. Look Absolutely. At how many books and how many kinds of books do you think completely different of now than you did a year ago? Because of BookTube.
Reading genres I never would have read before, authors I never would have found, books I never would have found, people I never would have found, obviously, is the big one. And the real tangible friendships as well, not just sort of an online communication with someone, but finding actual friends, making actual friends with these people is the other thing that I never would have expected. True friendships.
And that's worth a little bit of juggling your schedule, I guess, is the point here. So
absolutely.
Those payoffs are worth it.
Well, I agree.
Now I'm seriously thinking, should I make 6 videos a day?
I think that's what this whole video has been leading towards.
The more every time a BookTuber drops out, I add a video to my roster.
It's your responsibility to fill the void.
I so have
every
to fill
time we lose someone, your daily schedule increases by 1.
Although, like I mentioned, I'm feeling it now. Periodically, I get just a giant storm cloud of deadlines that are very real. They are very real. They will mean blank space if they aren't filled.
Interesting.
They will mean, firing if they right. aren't. They're absolutely, they are called deadlines for a reason. I usually keep those on a very rolling basis. So that they're not ever any kind of a weight, any kind of my equivalent of that moment when you're working up to going to work.
Yes.
But every once in a while, they have a mind of their own and they coalesce like shoals of tuna.
Yes.
This is one of those times.
Interesting.
One of those times where I'm feeling a slight amount of strain making 5 videos a day.
Yes. Well, we are, we just got less than 1 minute alert there. So I don't want it to cut off. But thank you so much for talking, Steve.
I think this is fascinating. I think a lot of BookTubers are going to be able to identify.
I think so. This Absolutely.
Split between work and BookTube and actual reading.
Absolutely.
How do you accommodate all of those things? That's fascinating.
It really is.
This is an engaging episode of the Micah Dialogues.
Indeed. Thank you, Steve, and thank you all for watching.
And we can also extend a vote of thanks to that weird rabbit.
Yes, and thank you to the weird rabbit.
Still sitting there.
Don't look at it. Don't make eye contact. All right.
Hair raising.
Oh, man. That's too good. All right. Let's see.